Good evening. We're talking to you from NUST, the Namibia University of Science and Technology. And this evening, we have some presentations on the top 25 supply chain managed organizations globally. We'll be hearing from our students, who are third year, final semester students here at the university. They'll soon be moving into the world of work or to further studies in logistics and supply chain management and transport. So this evening, I hope you'll enjoy the presentations on Starbucks, Coca-Cola, Nike, and PepsiCo. Thank you.
It attracts you to come and get a cup of coffee at Starbucks. that we are Starbucks workers, which are grass customers, come to Starbucks because we always give our customers discount, and this makes them want to come to Starbucks because it has a lot of benefits, and the customers keep returning instead of going to our competitors, such as McDonald's.
I'm in the lab. Actually, some of you I can see you are questioning yourself that where is this one coming from? So he was a customer and all that is now present for a company. Don't worry. There is that thing called customer loyalty. I'm just saying, have a loyal customer.
So where? Let me take you through Starbucks versus competitors, and it's under product differentiation. So product differentiation is actually one of the quarters, a generic strategy of competitive advantages. So well, looking at product differentiation definition, it's actually defined whereas a company attempts to increase its competitive advantage. So they do that by increasing customers' willingness to buy or pay for the product instead of being offered. So well, according to Starbucks, it's 2013, Starbucks sales were actually recorded as leveling down due to an increase in part of competition from the firms like McDonald's and Dunkin', yeah. So they were actually forced now to find ways for how to reduce their cost in order for an organization to increase their profit margin, but also maintaining or competing with other firms. So well, as a result, then Starbucks managed to introduce a management. They achieved to introduce strategies into their supply chain management that allow them or help them to reduce their cost. Okay, so and also it also helped them to establish their prices without having to sacrifice their core strategy, which is our product differentiation. So moving on to Starbucks, they said the further statement that product differentiation was actually is always at the core. It's always at the hard core of it's always it has always been their core that to gain a competitive advantage. So. Okay, moving on to conclusion. So we said the differentiation strategy of being premium and a unique coffee provider has actually helped Starbucks to maintain its or to sustain its competitive advantage. Millions of customers visit Starbucks week by week. So they come to 1% as I said coffee to enjoy a cup of coffee after coffee of the first period. The first week brewed coffee. Therefore, today Starbucks is actually looked at as the leading leader into as a retailer for as a retailer and course and a brand, especially coffee in the world. Hence, it's regarded as one of the companies in the top 25 companies with the best supply chain in the world. So, touching the whole of the mission of Starbucks, they said 1% one cup of coffee. And they say that 1% one cup of coffee and one neighborhood at a time. So, time, quality, quantity, and custom relationship. It's very, very important. Those are the essential factors that need to be maintained in the supply chain to make it run so efficiently and effectively along or within an organization. For me, Tinalo, and the rest of my group, we say thanks, ladies and gentlemen.
Coca-Cola, internationally well-known and reputable brand. So it'd be interesting to hear what we can hear about their supply chain management.
Let me know if you guys can hear me properly. Or if I'm too fast, because I can talk fast. Just raise your hands away. I'm not hearing that. My voice is a bit squeaky. Please let me know if you guys can hear me properly. Or if I'm too fast, because I can talk fast. Just raise your hands away. I'm not hearing that. We did offers. My name is Herta. Herta Ushona. I'm going to do the presentation on behalf of our group. And I hope you guys will understand everything that we have to capture for you. My group members are Mika Potolela Issa, Aimee, and Steven Petrus. This is supply chain and how it gets to be part of the 2025.
Mainly Coca-Cola's values are to refresh the world and to inspire moments. If you see many of Coca-Cola's efforts, they mostly say refreshing taste or refreshing drink. So mainly those are their main values, to refresh you guys, to give you guys an optimum taste that when you're drinking, you know you're refreshed, you know it takes away your thirst. It wants to create value to make a difference. It wants to separate itself from all the other soft drinks and create its own mark as you're drinking Coke, you know this is Coke, and this is why many of you guys are mostly addicted to it, as I can see a few bottles here. Coca-Cola tries to maintain a market advantage by dominating, making sure that 95% of the drinks they produce in their specific countries are supplied into their specific countries. Why are they doing this? Why are they trying to maintain a market advantage by doing this? By making sure that producing in their country, that's where they're producing their country and deliver in their country. Well, Coca-Cola does this because it tries to avoid excessive costs that comes with producing products in another destination and then having them to deliver them in a country or where you want to resell the product. Hence why it maintains a market advantage with this, because many countries, we all know that many African countries who produce goods don't necessarily sell them here. Although they produce Coca-Cola in Namibia, they do also sell it to other countries. But however, they make sure that 95% of the drinks they produce in that certain country are sold in that certain country. That way they have a direct contact with the supplier, they have a direct contact with the retailers that they sell to, and of course you guys consumers. Also the other thing why they do this is because it improves time limit. When you're looking at lead time in the supply chain, you don't want your product getting a call while you're in SA and the supplier says, I'm out of Coca-Cola now. My clients want to order 20 bulk of Coca-Cola, and then they say, but then that will take us 3 days. So producing in that country and supplying in that country makes shorter lead time and makes it more efficient to the supply chain. When it comes to building supplier relationship, Coca-Cola has guidelines on how they choose the suppliers. Yes, you'll probably be thinking, but what do they need suppliers for? The bottles, the branding, sometimes some of those are also done by outside suppliers. The sugar that goes into the drinks are done by outside suppliers. Mainly what they look at is the total cost of the supply. You as a supplier, as supplying us, are you able to say, if we say we increase our quantity today, we still want a ton of sugar and not 500 that we normally used to order it from you. Are you able to supply us with that quantity? This is one thing they look at. Then they look at the high quality and quantity of your goods and services. You're a supplier, you supply us with sugar, you've been in the market for so long, but are you able to meet our quantity? Are you able to meet our quality requirements? This is another guideline they look at when they're selecting their suppliers. And then they look at the delivery. Is your delivery willing to exceed our requirements? If let's say someone wants it in 30 days, are you able to deliver within the first 5 days, although our requirement not necessarily says that we want it out in the next 30 days? And then it looks to continuous innovation and growth. How is the supplier working? Are they constantly growing? Are they constantly producing new products? Are they constantly in the market trying to make sure that the supply chain and that the supplying goods to the services to the retailers is actually constantly growing? Is there growth? If there is no growth, Coca-Cola will not work with you, because as they're constantly trying to improve the brand, they need a supplier that can constantly grow with their improvements as well. And then now we look at the supply chain of Coca-Cola. What makes it unique? What makes it different from the rest? Well, Coca-Cola operates a multiple brand supply chain. When I say a multiple brand supply chain, is that it has different brands underneath one supply chain. It has multiple brands underneath one supply chain. In the sense that they deliver or they supply different products, however, it's all under one brand, which is Coca-Cola. If you look at a Fanta bottle, yes, the highlight does say Fanta, but at the end it still says Coca-Cola. This says Bonapa, but it still says Coca-Cola. So the supply chain is one, however, it's different products in the same supply chain. And then the other thing what they do is they constantly, the reason why they have multiple products moving in one supply chain is because it constantly improves. You as a product, as a manufacturing company, you can't have five supply chains for each product. Then that limits you, because then at the end of the day, each supply chain will require its own different requirements. A supplier who wants Coke, who wants Fanta only, will say, but I only want Fanta. And now you have to have a truck that only delivers Fanta to the supply chain. That's why they chose to have a multiple brand supply chain, which is faster and easier to supply to the retailers and other customers like yourself. The main thing that we found out about Coca-Cola and why their supply chain tends to make to be one of the best in the world is the sustainability. They say that sustainability is the key to their supply chain. It's key to reasons why they're top of the 25 companies. But what do they mean when they mean sustainability is the key to an efficient supply chain? Well, sustainability means being able to always deliver within the period the consumer expects you to. For example, I'm sorry, maybe I might face. This is their supply chain process. This is an image of how the supply chain process works. On top we have the product replenishment, how the product works. We start from the marketing and sales, where marketing and sales tells you that no, but now the products, customers don't want that advert anymore. They're not into it, they're more into the Fanta. And then they go back, and then they go back to the planning. Planning is where they do the demand focus. How many Coca-Cola bottles or how much bulk is ordered per month? And then they have the ordering system. The ordering system is where the suppliers, the retailers, and the customers like yourself place an order. And then they have the manufacturing, whereby the manufacturer the goods, and they have the transport system. So that's the product replenishment on top. And basically this at the bottom is how they deliver. What happens? How does it get to you guys? You guys are here at the consumer. So then from transport, you have the dispatch. Dispatch is where are we delivering? You have the Bambuleg, you have Caprivi, Kabango, then you have the South. This is how the dispatch team that works it out. And then you have the warehouse, whereby goods are stored. When, for example, a warehouse in this example would be the different depots that Coca-Cola has in Namibia. That can be that warehouse. And then you have the bulk delivery. And when it comes to the bulk delivery, they have different types of delivery. They have direct store delivery, and then they use different types of trucks to do delivery. And then they deliver to the retailer, and then the retailer delivers to you guys. What ERP systems are in place in order for Coca-Cola to maintain the success in the supply chain? Well, Coca-Cola uses the Genesis program. Genesis program is an ERP advanced program that is produced or that they use in order to maintain the supply chain. This is no different from SAP, because Genesis is also an ERP program. I cannot say that there's a difference from Genesis to SAP, it's just the name, because at the end of the day, it helps them. And what Genesis does more is it does more of the improvements on the process, on the production process. That's more what it works for, the forecasting and all that. And then of course, they still have SAP in place. I found out from Coca-Cola here in Namibia that they don't use Genesis, they use SAP here. But in countries like Netherlands, of Europe, they use Genesis, as it is more advanced now rather than SAP. So you guys can look up Genesis. And then they have an automatic retroviral system. This is also just a system in place that eliminates errors. For example, errors that comes with orders, errors that comes with wrong production of goods. For example, when they had that part where they produced, where they had too much sugar in the bottles, then that's what the automatic retroviral system does. It kind of just brings back and tells you how much was brought back. then how close enough does Coca-Cola keep its relationship with customers? Well, as you see here, you're very happy with your bottles. So Coca-Cola tries to maintain a very strong relationship with their customers. I just please keep this because I want to show you guys the different transport, the logistical and distribution part of Coca-Cola, which is one of the reasons why their supply chain is also very efficient. Okay, yeah, we're moving on to distribution. Coca-Cola uses a direct store delivery. Here in Namibia, they use it as well. Direct store delivery is, Stephen, if you can just zoom in for me here. Direct store delivery is, whereby you have the manufacturer, and then the manufacturer, from the goods are delivered directly from the manufacturer to the retailer. You don't have a second supplier in the middle, or you don't have a second person delivering the goods to you. So basically, it's like invented. Goods are produced in our North industry, and then directly they move to the retailer. They deliver themselves with their trucks to the retail, to the different retailing shops. So what they call that is direct store delivery. And then they have different types of trucks that they use. They normally have the side load. If you guys seen if you guys saw the video of loading, I'm not sure. If you guys saw that video, they have the side load. Side loads are where the trucks go in, and then they have the hybrid trucks. Hybrid trucks are more advanced and they're more big and they have more space. And the other thing that contributes to the great supply chain is backhauling. Backhauling is when they deliver to Pick n Pay, for example, they don't drive back empty-handed. They, on the way to Pick n Pay, they stop by ShopRite, they get those empty trucks, and then they get, and then the shop assistant at ShopRite gives them the next order, and then they pick up those empty bottles or empty, back in the day when they used to use the bottles and not plastic bottles, they would do that because then that saves them the time instead of driving an empty truck to back to the manufacturer and then to come back again. They save time by using backhauling. Yes, and that's all in general what makes Coca-Cola more efficient and why the supply chain is one of the top 25. I'm not sure for how many times. Yeah, that's about it. In conclusion, you have seen different types of reasons why. This video was to just show you guys the conclusion of exactly how. It doesn't say much, it just shows you exactly why the supply chain is one of the best.
I'm Alastair again, and I welcome you all to our presentation about NIAC, the supply chain management, and how do they maintain or how do they do it with keeping amongst the top 25 countries over the globe. Well, according to Robert in 2012, he defines supply chain management as the act to maximize supply chain activities, that maximize the client's value, and also to achieve the substantial competitive advantage. To start with, what is NIAC all about? Actually, it's an American multinational corporate that involves in designing, manufacturing, and developing. It's more of the brand. They focus on the brand. While the market really, where they put more effort really is a brand. Where its manufacturing network consists of 700,000 factories in 42 countries. They also have. Okay, what NIAC does is they conduct their business in an ethical way, and they expect the same from their clients. This is a reason because they want to have the same terms and conditions all over the globe, because it's a multinational company. They want to have the same picture all over the globe. And it also has its 5 primary distribution centers in the US and 16 outside the US. And that statistic was by the end of 2014. To continue, what you're seeing on the screen is just the structure of NIAC as an organization. I'm not going to waste my time on that, so please let's go to the next slide. Well, to answer the question, why is NIAC successful, or how do they do it to keep it amongst the best top 25 countries? What they do is they put much emphasis, or they give serious attention to fundamental pieces of their brand, which are product endorsements and culture. Let me just quickly take you through what those products, what they do in detail. Product, since the beginning, NIAC always, they had a mission to They had a mission to stay true to their mission, which is creating the best product to their clients. And they endorsement is a term that actually says it's not a testimonial return or order that it's that advertise or promote a product. And not like I said, they are more into the brand. They invest huge amount of money in advertisement, meaning they keep on attracting and holding the best iconic athletes in the world, because most of the Nike brands are athletes. Like, you go to the gym, you find these youngsters in the gym with Nike brands. And in the culture, what they do in their culture is that in the culture is they try to make sure that their voices are heard, and through social medias and advertisement, what they do is they invest more money in advertising their brand, because they know through social medias, like youngsters, you are all over the internet. So if you wanna take something, like they say, if you don't advertise, nobody will know. So if you wanna get something to youngsters, what you do, the best platform to use is the internet. That's why they use internet and social medias. Okay, and my colleague will take it from there.
Good evening, class. I'm Philip Kamega, and I'm going to continue why Nike is successful. Nike managed its delivery in an effective way to improve their profit margin, reduce inventory, minimize profit markdowns, and ensure that customers receive their right products, their right assorted products within the required time. Manufacturing is outsourced due to cost. Innovation in product design, quality and leadership, premium services and tailored designs. Nike product portfolio features of premium products that command higher prices. Due to the higher prices, this differentiates them into the market structure and at the same time charge higher price than the competitors. Factory store offers the good positions. Nike provides a premium product to customer shopping for value. Due to the value that is involved, this allows them to have a higher shopping practices.
Nike distribution channel. Mainly Nike distribute its product in three major channels. The wholesaler, they sell to the wholesaler in local market, which is USA and international market. And they also sell to direct to customer, which is they sell from their factory outlet store and online by their website. They also sell to the global brand division.
Like manufacturing strategies. First, I have to tell you what the manufacturing of Nike, how it weighs before, and talk about the key manufacturing class in last. Okay, as I later mentioned at first, that Nike is having 700,000 factories in across the globe, which is like we don't own it. Nike doesn't own the factories, but we also from independent contractors. We include China, Vietnam, Malaysia, Thailand, and Indonesia. And then the key manufacturing class that Nike look on it is the lean manufacturing, which means their products, the apparel product and the footwear, they are all manufactured through a lean lines, which whereby they have to reduce the labor productivity and to reduce waste. And the other one is the material consolidation. They do this through the process of reduce the process of manufacturing through the vendors through which like manufacturing their products, and to reduce also the management of the waste management. They do also through manufacturing innovation and modernization. And we have like have through two manufacturers, the two grand manufacturers, but they are not being manufactured in USA, but they are manufactured in by independent contractors, whereby Vietnam contributes 48% and China contributing 28% and 25% from Indonesia. Apart from Manhuta, it's just the same with food, whereby they are not also produced inward. Manhuta in the US is produced also by independent contractors through their Manhuta, by Malaysia being appointed the most apparel production.
Well, just like any other businesses, Nike also has their competitors, and these are businesses in the sneaker market, which are Converse, New Balance, and Adidas. So just in case you don't know, Nike also has condoms, which you can ask, but you may want to try them. Like I said, most of the like so they charge you the youngsters just to with that we thank you and it's a company
participation. Mr. Ahmadi, presentation of Pepsi Company. Pepsi Company is actually one of the company that is operating in over like 200 companies in the United Kingdom as well as Latin America. Pepsi Company, its major competitor Coca-Cola Company, the majority of Pepsi Company revenue do not come from carbonated soft drinks, but then it usually comes from uncarbonated drinks. So Pepsi Cola has began like in 1898, and then it was the owner was Mr. Carl Bradham. It became known as PepsiCo when it merged with Frito-Lay in 1965. PepsiCo headquarters is actually located in New York, and it's actually the largest manufacturer of beverages in the world. And its manufacturing and marketing are like the wide variety of carbonated and non-carbonated drinks, as well as snacks. And PepsiCo takes the 15th position in the ranking of better supply chain management. And I think my colleague is going to take you through, then he's going to give you more details.
Meaning, taking through the supply chain model. PepsiCo supply chain model is based on the idea of collaboration and integration. So and responsible and sustainable sourcing. This is the use of land use policy engagement by making sure that people that they work with are from the ethically and responsible. IFP and distribution network and logistics management. This is basically about a relationship with retailers. So this that make their supply chain better by establishing a strong relationship.
Good evening everyone, I'm Kelly, like you introduced me earlier on. I'm going to focus on the success factors of Pepsi. PepsiCo has 18 mega brands, most of them being Lay's, Chips, Fritos, Doritos. They have Aquafina as a bottled water, and also, just so you know, it has the largest market in bottled water. And also, it has 43 billion in revenues each year currently. And then it has 185,000 employees, and then it has product innovation, like they constantly change the bottling of their Pepsi bottles just so they can, you know, appear more easier to handle or just attractive to the eye also. And then acquisitions and partnerships, they partner with restaurant chains such as Taco Bell, it's very popular in the United States, and then also with football leagues and basketball leagues, just so to, you know, bring celebrities in and make it, Pepsi look cool also to the outside. And then it has a lot of environmental, social, and economic responsibility. It's very important. And then Maya will continue with that in her presentation as a pest analysis. And also Pepsi takes serious in consideration on their SWOT analysis. They have noticed their strengths and they also their weaknesses. Their strengths include extensive distribution channel. PepsiCo products are served to more than 10 million stores per week, and then also in more than 200 countries. Another strength is that they have successful marketing and advertising campaigns. They spent more than 2 billion this year on advertising alone, so that also helps it to grow in the market. And then their weaknesses include a weak brand awareness. Pepsi is placed at a very bad competitive disadvantage due to Coca-Cola being their main rival, because they're better for some reason. And then another weakness is that they have low pricing. Pepsi is going to have very low prices in their products, and that also low pricing is associated with low quality, so that's very bad for them. And then the opportunities include the bottled water consumption growth. It is known that soon in the years that our bottled water consumption is to grow. And then also PepsiCo is the largest bottled water market, like I said earlier. And another opportunity is that increasing demand for healthier food beverages. Now, a lot of people moving to the world that we're moving to now, they're becoming very health conscious. So this has brought Pepsi another range of products to produce products that are healthier, low fats, less calories, and so on. And then lastly, there are threats, changes in consumer tastes. Now, consumers around the world, like I said earlier, have become very health conscious. So they have reduced their consumption of carbonated drinks like Pepsi or fatty snacks like the Lay's or Doritos. So that's a threat for them now. And then another threat, the last one, is water scarcity. Water is becoming very scarce all around the world. And this now has led to high costs in water, and also criticism for Pepsi because they use a lot of water in their carbonated drinks production. So that's one of the threats, and with that, I'm done.
Good evening, everyone. As we all know that brands strive to be distinct and to separate themselves from their competitors. So PepsiCo's key differentiation factors are the power of one line, the development of good for you and better for you products, and then its key differentiation with its biggest competitor Coca-Cola is that it has the following brands under its umbrella. Pepsi has, like she mentioned before, it has Mountain Dew, 7-Up, it has Lay's, Fritos, and Pepsi, of course. And then Coca-Cola, the brand that it has under its umbrella, is Coke Diet, Coke Light, Coca-Cola, Kinley Soda, and Kinley Water. And then the other key differentiating factor is that in India and Pakistan, it is the only country in the world where Pepsi oversells Coca-Cola, whereas in other parts of the world, Coca-Cola dominates. And the pest analysis is the political factors. PepsiCo is a non-alcoholic beverage, and it has to comply with the regulations by FDA consistently. And its competitors use a competitive pricing strategy, which PepsiCo has to keep in mind at all times as well. Its economic factor is that it only has labor available, because availability of labor is an important key factor, the main key factor. And in most countries, labor is expensive, and if it's offered cheaply, in most instances, there won't be proper training offered to the employees. The social factor is that lifestyle plays a great influence on the use of Pepsi products, and its advertising is designed accordingly. Its technological factor customers is that PepsiCo always has to focus on the latest distribution technologies and technological advances in their industry. It also, PepsiCo's greatest influence is also modern manufacturing techniques as well as applicable to their business vision, such as software and soft drinks, juices and snacks.
Ladies and gentlemen, when I take you through the way forward, the company's perspective is to say the overall mission is to increase the value of their shareholders' investment. The company aims for the greater sales growth, cost controls, and wise investment of resources. We believe that PepsiCo commercial success depends upon offering quality and customers through the provision of safe products, wholesome, economically efficient, and environmental sound. So, by providing a fair return to their investors while adhering to the highest standard of integrity, with this as their plan, gives the spot of being ranked as the position 15 in the annual supply chain management top 25. So, what gives PepsiCo their most competitive advantage is that it aims at introducing always new markets, and it aims for a diverse workforce. So this makes PepsiCo like successful in its supply chain, and yeah.
In conclusion, PepsiCo is guided by performance with purpose, delivering top-tier results in a way that sustains and respects business society and the planet.
Any questions?
Hey, good evening, and again, welcome to Namibian University of Science and Technology. Global Supply Chain Management. We'll be hearing some more student presentations this evening. And first up this evening we have McDonald's, famous as fast food supply chain company around the world, not so famous in Namibia because we don't have McDonald's in Namibia. But let's hear what we have to hear this evening. Thank you.
Hello students, good evening.
Good evening.
We are here to present McDonald's and why it is the top number second on the global supply chain list. I'm going to introduce my group. Okay, we are the team McDonald's. We have Mr. Vincent Cabana, which is me, Edna Ocruz, we got Pietres, Irene Cabanas, and Sharif Moyes. And we're going to start off with a bit of the intro video just to show us what we are all about. Stock in their warehouses, and we keep on communicating with them just to have a strong case. We also use accurate forecasting method, this DDA, which is the interlink between the client and the company. Then we also have a transparent supply chain. Our supply chain is so transparent that you can actually go back and check where your vendor is coming from. For example, you can go back to your secondary until the raw materials. So you can actually go back and trace it from the vendor to the processing to the manufacturer to the primary product. Now also, McDonald's also have one of the key, we have a key supplier, which is this guy, Mr. This brother company. Now this guy, what they do, they put a capacity to sell 15,000 restaurants just in Northern America. And they deliver 2 to 3 times per week. And then their capacity, it said that can cater for 250 to 750 restaurants. Also, they handle our warehousing, transport, and logistics. So they've got such big trucks that one truck is enough to fill a restaurant, so you don't need to send 2 or 3 trucks. And they've got shuttling to minimize the production. So what they do, normally they call before they come, and then they just arrive when the flow of business is a bit down. I'm going to go to my next colleague.
One of the key unique differentiators is our business model that we use. And the business model of ours, they have got 3 legs. Then our staff of the company itself, McDonald's, they train all the employees, they give all the mother company of McDonald's, give all the training to all the outlets, McDonald's outlets worldwide. And then the suppliers, they are educated, they are on the highest level. And then our franchises, they bring the spirit of entrepreneurship, of commitment to the communities. More than 80% of our outlets are run by franchisees worldwide. Our people go to the next one.
I was still talking on the differentiating factor of our staff is the unique cold chain. McDonald's has a unique cold chain whereby their products are kept fresh, they are kept nutritional, and they don't replenish. And then I will go to the open only part. McDonald's is open 24 hours a day. You can have your breakfast, lunch, or your dinner in there. It offers free Wi-Fi, or you can also charge your phone when you are dining or something. And the e-procurement system, they have an e-procurement system in place which is mostly used by the franchisees. They can order their products in a shorter time, and by using the e-procurement system they also get discount on the products that they order. And fourthly, it's the customized menu according to countries. McDonald's is based in many different countries, but before they enter a certain country, they go beforehand and find out what type of food people eat, especially if it's a fish-eating country, if it's a meat-eating country, and they customize their menu accordingly. I'll give over to my colleague.
Okay, I'm going to go through the financials. McDonald's, this is actually the three components, the most important three components that led McDonald's to be on the 25, top 15 back. I'm going to start with ROA, return on asset. Return on asset is basically an indicator of how profitable a company is related to their assets. And McDonald's return on asset as of end of June is standing on 13.68%. We're moving on to inventory turnover, how fast McDonald's can turn over inventory within a year. And they are standing on 40.68%. And we move on to revenue growth, which is basically their sales. Now, McDonald's basically still standing on as of the 11th October 2016 is $113.68 million. And basically that's the end of our presentation. This is our references. And thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Well, the amazing part about these three guys is that for them to come up with this company, one of the members sold their car to Lotus, which was worth more than a van, just to raise funds to come up with this brilliant company. Well, Apple is known for its quality designs and their attention detail. It also develops
electronic goods to customers, and we'll take you through about supply chain.
A very good evening to you all, Ron, and my dear colleagues. Well, today I'll be talking about the supply chain of Apple. Okay, well, Apple is known as the world leader of innovation, product design and development, marketing, branding, and ecosystem, the software for the ecosystem. Their product is basically the iPhone, the iPad, the Mac, the Apple Watch, and not forgetting the Apple TV. Apple, however, it sells their product through their online stores, online, they are direct for sales, their online stores, their retails, their wholesalers, and actually other retailers. When it comes to the supply chain of Apple, people are always wondering, why is it always successful? And people think and people believe it's because of their supply chain model. They believe it's because of their extraordinary inventory control. But the secret weapon is that it's because of the software ecosystem. However, on the screen is just a very flexible supply chain whereby my colleague just saying Apple is originated from the USA, California. So when they get their design and the development, they assemble the parts, like, you know, the products, the sources to China, the USA as well. And then from there, they manufacture it. And I think it's not a bit clear, but I'm sure you can see the Chinese flag there. So that's where they assemble it. So from assembling the product, they bring it back to California, the main, where iPhone is originated. From there, that's now how we, the customers, get to buy their products through the retail stores, the online, and then transport it through the FedEx transportation. So that will be all.
As we all know, that every company that is involved in a business has some things that make them succeed in life. So as we all know that Apple, they produce things that they make sure that they will want it themselves before they sell them to the consumers. And they make sure that everything they produce or before they bring them out, they make it better for people, for consumers to understand it better and to make it easier for them to use it. And the product is easy to use, simply because they don't really bring out things every time like Samsung and all that. They make sure that they reinvent the old products. They don't just bring out the things every time like Samsung and all those things. And Consulco, they offer great customer service. They make sure that their customers are being satisfied. If you don't understand or if you don't know how to use iPhone or iPad, they make sure that they teach you on how to do that before you break the thing or call them. So always, they are always ahead of its competitors. They make sure that they are always ahead of their competitors, and they make sure that they produce things before their competitors do it better than them. Thank you.
Key unique features of alcohol. Sorry. Well, I don't know if we all know this, but Apple is actually the company behind the patent of the slide to unlock feature. Well, yes. And then Apple is also known for its high quality products. The Mac Bentley is bulletproof, and most Apple products that are currently being that are on the market, we all know that they are so waterproof. Now the amazing part about this company is also, apparently in 2010, researchers of the USA found that this company was so rich that if it were to go on a shopping spree, it could actually buy 80% of America's top 500 companies. That's our goal. Yes. So, let's keep on the challenges.
Yes, when you're talking
one of the challenges we're looking at the cloning of A4 products from countries without licensing. When you're talking about cloning, this means the fake products we might be getting. We are talking of countries like China. China likes cloning most of everything. Countries like India. So that is one of the main challenges, because now since they are cloning, so people will not be able to buy the original product, so they prefer the fake one because it's cheaper. And another challenge is the competition, the competitor. Apple's competitor is basically Samsung. Why? Because Apple's it only targets, let me say, people like the standards, and you know, it's not for everybody. So now we people that we can't afford, we usually buy Samsung, and I'm sure most of us here we're just using Samsung phones. Why? It's not because we do not want iPhone, it's because Samsung is actually cheaper than iPhone. So that's actually one of the biggest challenges for people currently. Thank you.
What made Apple to be one of the top 25 successful company is because it's known for quality designs, and it's more reliable for customers to use, and it gives the best service. As Lavinia mentions, that whenever you buy something, they always teach you on how to use it. And Apple is always ahead of its competitors with the unique features of their product. For example, they are the owner of the slide unlock, as Evan mentioned, and their Mac is known as for bulletproof. And there are some challenges such as of cloning, which they get from Chinese, Indians, and Japanese. As you know, the Chinese likes this, so they like to clone this. And most customers prefer Android phones. Because they are more cheaper. Thank you. Well, thank you guys. This is the end of our presentation. Thank you for listening.
Next up, we have Caterpillar, internationally world famous for their heavy equipment, earth-moving equipment, and also famous for their supply chain technology. Be interesting to hear what this group has to say.
Last week, we are talking about Caterpillar. Caterpillar in the world with visual heat. Caterpillar in the world with visual heat. I mean the rich equipment machines, also small equipment machines we use for construction. Caterpillar is an American company which originated in America. They deal with heavy machines like this one you can see here. It's used to carry stones, sand, or any heavy materials. It's usually used in the construction of the mines. It is used to have a bigger road when they are being constructed to see the neighbors. Okay, so I'm going to talk about product mix, supply chain model, what makes them different from others, how we try to meet the customer demands, how we distribute our products around the world, the ARP system we are using, and kind of just complete from gather together. So to introduce this company, like as I said, it's an American company which designs, which engineers, manufacture equipment. We also do some financial aid to the construction companies, and also it deals across all of the countries in the world. Most countries in Africa, they get their equipment from South Africa, which is their main branch, but there are many other branches which are distributed across Africa. So today we are mostly based in Africa. The word is this Caterpillar we believe is the most rigid construction mining equipment in the world. So my next colleague will take over.
So I'm going to talk about the supply chain. So critically now within supply chain, Caterpillar wants to manage, okay, I want to level down part of the supply chain and the marketing services that they have, actually for the external companies that they are having that are used to other new products. So first of all, obviously, within Caterpillar, they want to manage or they want to leverage between their clients and the company as well. Because then with the high level of distributors and the high level of customers that they are having, they are one of the users. So if the customer doesn't, so if the government or the public is not requesting for a road to be built or anything like that, it wouldn't be in demand and then Caterpillar wouldn't actually be in the supply chain. So first of all, like I said, we have the request from the customer. So the customer is mostly one of the important things because then what you get is that you have a road that is built like Bani Makanja. It was abandoned for so many years. And because customers want good road infrastructures and everything, and then they go to the retailers, all the dealers that are dealing with this kind of things, you know. So they are ones that find the gap in the market and they are like, no, we need to produce this kind of products. And then after that, the distributor then is then what we now call Caterpillar at the end of the day. They are the ones that will now be able to distribute the tractors and the machinery and the goods for the workers and everything else. And then we have the manufacturers. The manufacturers are typically the people that are ordering. I mean, it's typically the people that are producing the products at the end of the day, including the suppliers now, who are obviously distributing the manufacturers with the end product for Caterpillar to be able to use.
I'll take you through the product mix of Caterpillar. Caterpillar offers over 300 types of products such as backhoe loaders, compactors, motor graders, pipelayers, off-road highway trucks, etc. These are mostly materials and machineries that are used in constructions and like through the roads when people are building and all that. All the heavy machineries that are used and the light machineries that are used, they are part of their product. Caterpillar is even seen in the gift and apparel marketplace where items such as clothing, footwear, toys and scale models are offered. So now they offer all these machineries and all that, but then one of the things that they really take a cautious in is the safety of each and every person or each and every customers of theirs that are using their machinery. So then they have safety clothes that allow them, that allows their customers to be safe when they are using their machines and also during their construction. Those are the picture on top. That's a picture of an example of their footwear, and then these are their trucks that they also do. They also manufacture the. This now allows, let's say, if it's in the mine, then it allows that their customers are also safe because these trucks are highly safe. What makes the firm unique? The company has 3,243 retailer shops across the world. So this allows them to reach out to almost all their customers across the world. They offer the best value and right products. They make sure that they know their customers' needs. They know. They make sure that they know their customers' wants, so that they know exactly what their customers need. At the end of the day, they produce the best and the right products. They have a customer-oriented approach. Before they produce, they make sure what do their customers need, what do their customers want, and according to the to what they get, then they produce that, and that just helps them to also increase their customer base and also get attract new customers because every customer wants a company that meets their needs and their wants. Meeting customer demands, Caterpillar operates a large service parts business that warehouses and distributes components to dealers and customers. Now they don't just produce in a, let's say they are producing in Asia, you are in Namibia and you want
but then because it's too far, then you have to wait for long. But then what they do is that if you're in Namibia, they have already a company in Namibia or a shop in Namibia that allows you to be very quick for you to go. And if you need a machine, for example, today, you get it very easily. The Adidas are responsible selling machines to the end customers and also for servicing machines that have been sold. So let's say you have bought a machine from Caterpillar and maybe you didn't use it right, or maybe something happened and it breaks, then the Adidas then can help and service, and they also teach their customers how to use their machines and all that, how to operate them, and that helps them to really keep their customers.
So I'm going to take over as well from here. So Caterpillar's distribution. So Caterpillar wants to add added value products. So what I'm saying is, by value products, they just do not want their workers or the people that are supplying to work in such an unsafe environment whereby it is having health hazards, yes, and also unsafe for people to work. So at the same time, like Petrina said, they are also unique in so many ways whereby they also are able to supply their workers, yes, all the people that are working with safety boots, for instance, and uniform as well, and safety glasses at the end of the day, because you are people that are having work, you are having people that are working for you, so you also want to have that kind of relationship whereby you are able to maintain their health in the area that they are working and everything. And then they also want, they also want to manage their material flow and storage management. So they don't want to run out of products immediately. They want to make sure that they have enough products at the right time, at the right place. They don't want when they, because we now have demand and supply at the end of the day. So you don't want when the demand is so high, you don't have anything to supply, you don't have anything to supply the business with anything. So they want to balance the two equations to make sure that the equipment or all the manufacturing products they have are available and the storage areas and everything, so that it's easier for them to import and export the products to make it easier for the business to operate. So I'm going to move over to the ERP system. So the ERP system, they have the supplier relation management system, and then they have the customer relation management system. So the supplier relation management system, they don't want more goods to come into the company than what they have ordered, and they also don't want to have an inflow of less goods as well that are coming to the business. They want to make sure that if they order an amount of 100 products, that is what they get exactly. So they use a system that they can actually use to control this kind of inventory and products at the same time for them to move smoothly. And then also customers. They also want to make sure that when customers or when suppliers actually requesting for this product at the end of the day, they do not want their customers to then come and say, no, I ordered an amount of how many products. They want to be 5 or 10 steps ahead of the customer, so they want to make sure that the customer get their products at the right time. So they have to use a customer relation management system for them also just to build that connection with them and the customer at the end of the day, for them to have a long-term relationship to have that customer.
Just to conclude, Caterpillar, with its supply chain and their different ERP system, it really helps them to be one of the best companies with the best supply chain model. And it has selected worldwide. It's one of the selected worldwide biggest brand with high quality. It's easy to get. It's parts. I mean, if you go to any construction or to any mine, you find a product of Caterpillar, if not all. So in all that, the fact that they have good relationship with their customers, with their suppliers, it then helps them to be one of the leading companies. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Johnson. Okay, and here we are with Johnson & Johnson. again, internationally renowned, this time in the cosmetics and fast-moving consumer goods, FMCGs. So it'll be interesting to hear what this group has to present on Johnson & Johnson.
Johnson & Johnson, our supply chain use a tool called Procurement Sustainability Initiative, whereby we ask the suppliers, how worth is your sustainability program? What we mean by this is that some companies, when they use, they make pharmaceutical products, some of them they test their products on animals, and then later on they just dump them there, like vulnerable. So we need to have environment. We need to care about the environment. So we also use this procurement sustainability initiative to provide the foundation that we give to our procurement professionals. For example, like if you are purchasing a certain product, like to make baby powders, or we sell also baby powders. So we need to check with which company that produce those materials, which we can use to produce the best powder that can suit our customers. We also use ERP systems to coordinate us with the companies that, for example, our retailers, whether they are out of stocks or not. We also use SAP, and then what we forget to mention is also this new system they are using, Genesis. We're also using them in our supply chain management. As we conclude this, we continue to emphasize on supply and problems, because our supplier are the ones or the reason why we are there. So we believe that for our supply chain to be more effective and successful, we should deliver at the right time, right quantity, and then to the right customer.
Okay, last one.